Welcome to another edition of the Carolina Bay of the Day, where we study the secondary impacts made by the glacier ice boulders that were ejected by an extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide ice sheet. This is part 3 of a trilogy about the Carolina Bays of Hoke County, North Carolina. In this part, we will examine overlapping Carolina Bays and try to determine the geological mechanisms that created them. This is a LiDAR image of an area of about 26 square kilometers or 10 square miles near Bowmore, North Carolina. You will find a link to the LiDAR visualization tool for Google Earth by Michael Davias in the description of the video. This area should already be somewhat familiar to you from the previous two videos of the trilogy. We will be paying close attention to the bays in the upper left corner of the image. Bay number 1 has a length of 469 meters and well-defined rims. Bay number 2 also has well-defined rims and a length of 981 meters. We can verify that these two bays are elliptical by fitting them with ellipses. There is no question about it. They are conic sections, and these bays most likely originated as penetration funnels which are inclined conical cavities. These two bays were made by the last of a series of impacts in this area. The ellipses with dotted lines indicate the elliptical scars of the impacts that preceded the formation of bays 1 and 2. We have to keep in mind that when the meteorite struck the Laurentide ice sheet, it had an excavation time of about 30 seconds, and glacier ice boulders were ejected in ballistic trajectories that impacted the ground 6 to 9 minutes later. This landscape of Carolina Bays is the result of the horrific hailstorm of secondary ice impacts that lasted about 3 to 4 minutes. The projectiles that arrived first made the dotted ellipses, and the ones that arrived last made bays number 1 and 2. The LiDAR image without the ellipses shows all these features, and they are easy to see once you know what to look for. The rectangle identifies another area that we need to study carefully. It includes a small bay near the Hilltop's Finest Market that we discuss in part 1 of this trilogy about the Carolina Bays of Hoke County. We can see right away that the bays marked 1 and 2 are just the last ones that were placed on top of several other bays that preceded them. We can verify that these Carolina bays are elliptical, as they should be if they were created by oblique impacts that created inclined conical cavities. We can see that bay number 2 is overlapping bay number 3, marked with a dashed line, that preceded the emplacement of bay number 1. The LiDAR image also shows that bay number 2 was emplaced on top of another bay whose rim is indicated by the arrow. When we fit ellipse number 4 to the rim of the bay, we notice that there is another rim that is still unmarked. This means that there was an additional bay number 5 that preceded the formation of bay number 2. We notice that there are two small bays within bay number 4. This is something that is also observed in experimental impacts. These two small bays were also emplaced in a particular sequence. Bay number 6 was emplaced first. Bay number 7 was emplaced on top of bay number 6. Here we see the interpretation of the landscape with all the bays marked. This location was heavily bombarded by the secondary glacier ice boulders. Things are never as simple as they appear. The interpretation of the geomorphology of the Carolina Bays poses many problems. Fortunately, the analysis of the bays is facilitated because we know that the bays are elliptical, and mathematically, only 5 points are needed to fit an ellipse to an elliptical curve. This means that we can fit ellipses to a bay even when a portion of the rim is obscured by other bays. Let us now look at the large bay on the right side of the image. Is this only one bay or two overlapping bays? We see that one ellipse fits both sides of the rim of the bay, therefore it is only one bay. What appears to be the rim of another bay is an incursion into the bay by the movement of the terrain due to the difference in elevation. The green area within the ellipse corresponds to an elevation of 72 meters above sea level. The yellow area to the northwest of the bay has an elevation of 75 meters above sea level. We can attribute the distortion of the bay to mud flow from the terrain at 75 meters above sea level to the terrain at the lower elevation of 72 meters above sea level. We also notice the rim of a small bay that is within the large bay. Based on the geological law of superposition, this small bay could only have formed after the large bay. We only examined an area of 26 square kilometers or 10 square miles, which is less than 3% of the area of Hoke County, North Carolina. Many books could be written about the elliptical geomorphology of the Carolina Bays and their origin as penetration funnels made by secondary oblique impacts of glacier ice boulders that were ejected by an extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide ice sheet. It is unfortunate that many geology courses still consider the Carolina Bays to be like thermokarst lakes created by wind and water mechanisms. But I have high hopes that the arguments that I have presented here on the basis of geometry will eventually convince even the hardcore uniformitarians. Thank you for joining me in the investigation of the Carolina Bays. I will continue to examine the Carolina Bays one bay at a time. My book about the Carolina Bays is available at Amazon. Please subscribe to be notified of future videos about the Carolina Bays.